Repetition is the mother of skill. Repetition is the mother of skill. So when it comes to chest pain, I'd like you to focus on the term PAPA, P-A-P-P-A. It's a great mnemonic to keep your brain focused on the five most important things we have to focus. It's our priorities. I mean, it's really what we do in business. It's what we do in life. Hopefully, you got to stay focused on priorities. What's important to you? Now, PAPA is the mnemonic, P-A-P-P-A, five causes of chest pain, P-A-P-P-A, okay? Five causes of chest pain: pericarditis, acute coronary syndrome. The first two are your heart. That's why you're beating on your heart. Second two are your lungs, pneumothorax, PE. Last one is thoracic dissection, or the big blood vessel coming off of your heart. If you've been following the series, you know we've covered P-A-P. Now we're on the second P, pneumothorax. Now, I got to be real clear with you. I've taken advanced trauma life support five times. I've worked critical access emergency medicine. I really don't think I'm a trauma guy. Like, I'm trained in trauma, but I never worked at a trauma center. I'm much more of a medical guy. I'm much more comfortable with STEMIs and sepsis patients and DKA, arrhythmias. The trauma, we would get them when they come in, and clearly I'd have to manage them, and I've managed my share of trauma codes. I put in not a lot of chest tubes, 20, maybe just as many AeroCath, these little small catheters. So no, I always think it's really important when you're talking to a speaker, what's their experience? You know, if someone's teaching me a surgical airway, I want to ask them, how many have you done? Okay, it's one thing to learn technique. It's another thing to learn experience behind the technique. So I don't want to pretend ever, none of my speakers, I never want anybody to pretend that they're something that they're not. That only harms the exchange of information. When I'm at a business conference, I want to know what's their business experience so I can listen to them in the most appropriate discernment. Okay, so I don't think I'm a real great trauma guy. Every time I've had to run a trauma code or I had a major trauma coming in, I'd always have to run ABCs, airway. Is it open? Will it stay open? Do I need to make it patent? Breathing? Are they exchanging gases right? Oxygen, carbon dioxide? Circulation? What's their blood pressure? What's their pulse? What's their perfusion? And anytime I felt like I got confused, start over. Relax, start over. ABCs. Now, when it comes to a pneumothorax, I want to give you some bits of advice. Use it as you will, but understand something. A pneumothorax is a collapsed lung. It comes on very briskly. A lot of times it's from a trauma, okay? And then I don't think it's super difficult to pick up the pneumothoraces from a trauma. That's what I believe. Not super difficult, because you're going to be looking for it. It's kind of like with chest pain. You know, we have some things that we do pretty automatically. We do an EKG within 10 minutes, where if they come with chest pain, our radar is really high for acute coronary syndrome. It's not that they're not missed a lot of times. It's just, it's on our radar based on ACLS and American Heart Association protocols. With trauma, pneumothorax, we know it's devastating. You know, people, that's one of the most treatable causes of a traumatic death. So we're looking for it all the time. The concern is a spontaneous pneumothorax, and classically it's a tall, skinny guys, but understand that this does not come on gradual, it comes on very briskly. My experience is if you have a young teenager, tall teenager that acutely short of breath, always look for the pneumothorax. Now, plain film x-ray is the initial diagnostic test. I know the literature does not necessarily support this, an IE ratio, an inspiratory-expiratory radiograph. I found it helpful. I know the literature doesn't say it's a really great diagnostic tool. I still like it. Anytime I've been concerned about a pneumothorax, but I couldn't see it on x-ray or I thought it was equivocal, scan them. Do a CAT scan without contrast, and that's 100%. You can't miss it on a CAT, a plain film CAT without contrast. Now, the treatment. If you're an advanced practitioner, you have to be aware that, hey, There's one absolutism. The absolutism is a tension pneumothorax needs a needle decompression. Now, you have to ask the question, what's the difference between a simple pneumothorax and a tension pneumothorax? Now, in Malcolm Gladwell's book, The Tipping Point, I'm a huge fan of Malcolm Gladwell. He's a brilliant speaker on how we think. He wrote a book called Blink. He talked about, you know, how we can make spontaneous, intuitive judgments in a blink of an eye that's very accurate. He wrote a book called David and Goliath, how we could get leverage over someone who may be bigger and stronger if we use our advantages. In the book where he talks about, I completely lost my train of thought. Oh, holy cow, tipping point. Hello. Wow. My father used to say there's three different signs of getting old. The first one is loss of memory. The second one is I can't remember the second one. Whatever. But in the book Tipping Point, he talked about what makes something tip over. What makes something tip over and become viral? And he said there's three major components of that. Number one is the person spreading the information. Are they connector? Like, there were two people that went out that night that Paul Revere said the British were coming. Paul was a connector, okay? So number one is the speaker or the connector. Number two is the context and the content, okay? The context of what's being said, like the British are coming, is very impactful. But the stickiness of the topic, how well can you say it one time and people really get it? What I found here, this is a very sticky thing I'm gonna say. What's the difference between a simple pneumothorax and a tension pneumothorax? And the answer is shock. Are they in shock? Are they in shock? Now, we'll do a follow-up talk throughout the podcast on really what shock is, but let me give you some basics. Understand that you have three major organs, your brain, your heart, and your kidneys, and those suck up most of your blood supply. And if you ain't perfusing those three, that's when they're in shock. That's when we're in decompensated shock because they ain't doing a good job. They ain't doing a good job of perfusion our tissue. And if you ain't perfusing your brain, your heart, or your kidneys, you ain't perfusing your cells. So you're going to start building up lactic acid. Now, we'll talk about the perfusion of the heart, the kidney, and the brain, but understand this. The two major features of shock are if your blood pressure is low, you ain't perfusing those three organs, and if you ain't perfusing your brain, you're going to be altered. So those should be the two key things you look for, is hypotension, altered mental status. Is that an absolutism? No, it's a pretty darn good one, though. I have found with shock, especially acute onset of shock, sometimes you just got to be at bedside. You got to have a little bit of experience to go, this guy's not doing well. I don't feel good about this one. So if you have someone who's in a tension pneumothorax or hypotensive with altered mental status, they're circling the drain, the last thing you do is a chest x-ray. It's a clinical diagnosis. You put your stethoscope on their chest and you listen and say, boy, I don't hear lung sounds on the right. The jugular veins are distended. The trachea looks deviated because, guys, it's a big amount of air. It's a big bubble in the chest that has to be popped. Second intercostal space, mid-clavicular line, you go over a rib, you go in with a large bore needle. If you hit the tension, there's a large rush of air. You immediately know that you are successful. You immediately know. Now, here's my dilemma. There have been times when I've had a crashing patient. Things are a little bit loud in the code room, and I don't know if I can trust my ears. Am I really hearing decreased lung sounds? Bottom line is, guys, the patient's crashing and they're dying. You do the best you can. And if you can't hear lung sounds that are symmetrical, you make that announcement. I do not hear symmetrical lung sounds. Put the needle in. Just do it. Go for it. Just do it, okay? The patient's dying anyways. No one's gonna die from the needle decompression. They will die from the tension pneumothorax you didn't fix. So the bottom line is put the needle in, okay? If you find the cause and you resuscitate them, great. They will need potentially a chest tube or an aero cath. But don't be a wimp about this, okay? They're dying. They're gonna die. You better figure it out. So do the needle decompression. Have the courage to do it, okay? So that's an absolutism. If you have a tension pneumothorax, they need a needle decompression. Wait, how do you know if they're tension? Well, they're in shock. That's the absolutism. Again, second intercostal space, mid-clavicular line. ATLS is very, very good at teaching you and training you to do this. Remember, if you have a pneumothorax and you intubate them, you put more positive pressure in their chest. It makes the pneumothorax get worse quicker. And please remember, guys, when you have a pneumothorax, it's getting big. It's shifting everything over. So it shifts all your neck structures away, and they look sick. And it's easy to see. Even if you have someone with a lot of redundant tissue in the neck, that jugular veins bulge out pretty well. So remember, guys, when it comes to chest pain, there's five causes of chest pain. PAPPA, pericarditis acute coronary syndrome, pneumothorax PE, and aneurysm. Today we talked about pneumothorax. Now the chest tube and the aerocath, I'm not an expert to give you feedback on that. That's really, you know, are there times that we leave small pneumothoraces without putting a chest tube or aerocath in? There are times. But I don't have that discernment. I'm going to run that by a surgeon. I'm going to talk to somebody about that. If they're not attention, I got time to negotiate this with somebody else. And I do that. For any of my the physicians out there, you guys are experts at this, especially the board-certified ear docs. I mean, you do this all the time. If the patient is stable, even if they're symptomatic and stable, the stable is the key term there. If they're stable, we got time. It's kind of like a tachyarrhythmia. An unstable tachyarrhythmia, they need synchronized shock. We don't call for a consultation. You sedate them, give them some analgesics, and you do a synchronized cardioversion, and you fix them. We don't have time to debate that. Tension pneumothorax, they need needle decompression. If you have a trauma code that comes in, they should get bilateral chest tube, bilateral needle decompressions to make sure they're not tension pneumothorax. If you have a respiratory arrest, You shouldn't call a respiratory arrest until you put two needles in them to make sure they don't have a tension. And if you hit a tension, it's very, it's like you let the air out of a balloon, and it's pretty impressive. John Blinsky here from the Emergency Medicine Institute. You're listening to Talk EM.